So I have not been through this deck before. This is a brand new presentation just for you. I do have a presentation that's very similar to this called Building Better Products, and it's all about, it's mostly about extreme programming, and I touch on product management in it. But you guys know about extreme programming already, so I figured it would be best to just do something that was more focused. So, extreme product management. Let's see if I can make this work. Okay, that's me. You guys don't need to know more about me. All right. These are two of my favorite quotes about Apple. First off, from Eric Ries, the author of The Lean Startup, thinking big is not at odds with starting small. This is one of those things that we have trouble communicating to our clients often, right? Because the clients walk in and they're like, no, not this. But we have to coach them to get down to this, right? And build lots of little ones of these in order to get to the big thing. The other one that I really like and that I think is particularly applicable to labs is from my friend Dan Ward, who says the most successful project leaders from government and industry alike tend to deliver top shelf stuff with a skeleton crew, a shoestring budget, and a cannonball schedule. Right? When you make everything small, when you apply constraints to things, you deliver better products. And that's what we do here every single day, right? We're coaching our clients to make the smallest thing they can make in order to make the best thing they can make. If you like this quote, the book Fire that Dan wrote is awesome. It stands for fast, inexpensive, restrained, and elegant. Dan was with the Air Force for 25 years, and he worked in procurement. And he did a study where he found that projects that had constrained budgets and constrained schedules and small teams were almost invariably more successful at delivering good outcomes than projects that had huge budgets, long schedules, and massive teams. So, and the book is all about that, so you should totally read it. All right, everybody here should be familiar with the Agile Manifesto, right? This was written in February 2001 as a reflection of the current state of best principles in software development. And it still holds true today, both as a reflection of and an influence on modern software development. But in the last 5 years or so, and really the last 2.5 to 3 years at Labs, the values of the Agile Manifesto have transcended just the software development side and spread to design and product management as well. And I think this is due in large part to the advent of a balanced team as an idea, and I'm going to talk about balanced team in a little while, but also Lean Startup and Lean UX, both of which were heavily influenced by XP. And as I talk through how product management works here, you'll see how each of these aspects of the Agile Manifesto comes through. So I'm going to touch very briefly on this here because it's at the center of everything we do. So at Pivotal Labs, we practice extreme programming. And as we saw in yesterday's lunchtime video, was anybody absent for yesterday's lunchtime video? Everybody was here? It was a Kent video at lunch yesterday? Damn. You gotta go see it. So Kentech is awesome. Always good to see. So anyway, as you saw in the video yesterday, XT was pioneered by Ken Beck, one of the original signatories of the Agile Manifesto. And XP asks, how little can we do process-wise and still build great software? Right? We don't want to get bogged down in processes and documentation, so let's always work with the bare minimum that's necessary. Second, building software is hard and often runs into unpredictable difficulties. So how do we make a system that can recover quickly from these missteps and turn failure into something that is more successful? Oh, that's not what I wanted. I wanted to scroll in my notes. We also need to be able to provide better options for making business decisions. And we can only do that with a flexible system. And this whole system is driven by a core set of values: communication, simplicity, feedback, and courage. If you feel like you need a refresher on any of this stuff, as Ken mentioned again yesterday, the second edition of XP Explained. Personally, I think the first 7 chapters of the second edition of XP Explained are some of the best business advice that I've ever read anywhere. It's about the socio-emotional requirements for being a good participant on a team and creating good products. So if you haven't read it, please do. If you have read it, but it's been a long time, it might be worth revisiting. Okay. So with that preamble, let's look at what a product manager actually does. I'm going to start by looking at a couple of job descriptions. Yes. This I was looking for. Collaboration. People working. It ends up looking like Berger is mansplaining to Laura, which is Lauren, which is not exactly what I wanted, but it was the best picture.
Does it say farming? Farming versus construction?
Probably. Yes. Berger is... Have you met Jonathan Berger? It's a very interesting man. Anyway. So we're going to look at some job descriptions of product managers. What do you guys think you're going to see? Anything in particular that you think you're going to see in these job descriptions?
Massive confusion between product and project manager.
Slave driver of time.
Okay. What else?
Ridiculously low salaries.
The job descriptions seldom include salaries because they want you to actually come in first and then they'll tell you.
Then they'll tell you.
So, slave driver of time.
Agile certifications.
Agile certifications.
PMG or agile.
These are from the outside world. These are not our job description. So that's a good start. I think you're actually going to be a little surprised. These are from a relatively friendly organization, though. So this is one of the fairly typical descriptions of a product manager. It has things like develop a product vision, discover product market fit, know how your products are being used, use data to improve the product is on there somewhere. What is what?
User testing, prototyping, geotech scrum, the second point on the top, on the end of that line.
Dual track scrum.
Dual track scrum is probably
two streams.
If I had to guess, you've got two work streams, so you're managing.
Be like mobile and back end.
Yeah. So this one's actually, it's not so bad. They're looking for a few technical abilities, you can see down here. But more importantly, they're asking for an ability to adapt agile methodologies, which is a good sign, since we're talking about adaptation and not just
adaptation.
Like growth hacking.
This looks more like growth hacking.
There is growth hacking.
And that's not outside the realm of what many product managers do at companies that are full-time product companies. So we're a consulting company, we're a little bit different. Right. Some of the things that you're going to see here are totally normal for product managers, but we just never get the opportunity to do them here because we don't stay with the client long enough. Like finding product market fit, we're almost never on a project long enough that we're able to guide that product to product market fit. So for those of you who aren't familiar with the term product market fit, it's where basically demand for your product requires you to scale. So you've gotten to the point where your customers want your product so much that now it's time to scale your operations. We really never see that here, right? The products that we build are often so early stage that we don't get to see whether or not there's enough demand for them to keep moving. Anyway, let's see. Let's take a look at another one. This one's similar, but it has some slightly different words. One of the things I like here is it's asking for the ability to gather and synthesize feedback from customers and use it to define a product roadmap, which is something that I agree with a little bit less, and functional requirements. Let's see. Champion customers internally is a nice one, and creating a tight feedback loop with engineering. Those are good. Some similar technical requirements, but it adds things like the ability to think about the vision and an entrepreneurial streak. What is that? Creative entrepreneurial streak with strong business acumen. These are all good things. Okay. A few good things in this one too. It's looking for someone who is a people person, who's able to drive large complex projects to completion, although I'd argue the big part of our job is seeking the simplicity in those large projects. I love that this one actually touches on metrics, actually defining metrics. That's a big part of what product management should be doing, and I'll talk a little more about that in a little while too. And finally, someone mentions collaboration here. I'm not sure where they have it, but I know it's on here. Anyway, collaboration is essential to everything that we do, as you guys should know. So this one is a little scary, and I put this one on here as a contrast. This one comes from a very large, well, it says, it comes from Citi. And it's asking for things like driving customer loyalty and driving business value and all those things that should be considered ancillary outcomes of driving customer value. And that's not mentioned here anyway. Citi apparently doesn't care if they're providing value to you as long as you're providing value to them. So, not what we do.
So can I repeat the last one? About who provide who the product manager provides value for? You said that they asked for somebody to drive.
Right. So Citigroup's post for a product manager is looking for someone who can drive customer loyalty.
Oh, can you go back? Did you say the Citigroup one? That's because we just
the Citigroup.
Oh, interesting. Because they've been looking for someone for 3 months and they can't find someone.
Yeah.
Well, this is for different though.
Yeah. Probably a different post. They're looking for a VP of product management in Singapore. But that's not the post that I chose for this one. So driving customer loyalty is something that is good for them, but it doesn't actually, there's no expression of value for the customer there, right? And so I feel like that's kind of the wrong direction, and it's not the approach that Labs product managers would typically take.
Right.
So they also talk about driving business value. And again, no mention of the value for the customer. So it's like, as long as the customer is providing value to Citi, they're cool. All right, there are also product managers in the world who have nothing to do with software. So I just wanted to throw this up here for an example. There are products in the world that are not made out of ones and zeros. This is actually for a trade product. It's a trade-related thing. I can't remember what TTS stands for. Treasury and Trade Solutions. And this person, some of the
considering the situation Puerto Rico is in right now, that's hilarious.
So some of the responsibilities of this person are similar to some of the responsibilities you would see in a software product manager, but they are not the same. So
you guys know Puerto Rico is bankrupt, right?
Puerto Rico's bankrupt. Okay, so what are the most important things to look for in a product? Oh, already saw that one. What are the most important things to look for in a product manager? First off, she needs to be able to develop a product vision, right? Actually see what this product could do for customers. Discover product market fit. Again, not a thing that we often get to do here at Labs. But it is important. And as consultants at Labs, we do get to coach our customers to help them figure out what product market fit is going to look like for them, in some cases, not in every case. Understand and advocate for customer needs. So this is the gather and synthesize feedback from customers and champion the customer internally. I think this is a huge responsibility of the product manager that is shared with the design team. Understanding product metrics and knowing what to look for. Wow, the spacing on that got really messed up. Okay. So what is it that makes us different? Turns out, if these are things that product managers do everywhere, what makes us different? Oh, we also work collaboratively. Okay. It's not just the costumes that makes us different. This is the PM team from San Francisco about a year and a half ago. Sadly, the only one who's still in San Francisco is Sue Chow. He's in Ireland, he's in Boulder, she's in Sydney, she's in Tokyo, he left, and he left. But we have a new team there that is equally awesome, they just don't tend to wear as many costumes. So, the thing that makes us different is we are extreme. That was the highlight of the whole thing. You guys can like focus on your lunches at this point. So, what does that mean to be an extreme product manager? First, let's take a look at what extreme programming looks like here at Pivotal Labs, and then we'll see how this all transfers over. So, first off, XP here is team-focused, right? This goes back to the Agile Manifesto. Individuals and interactions over processes and tools, right? We have small teams, we pair all the time, we care about each other, we treat each other well. Okay? Second, we are values-driven. We believe deeply in communication, simplicity, courage, and feedback, those four things that Kent Beck talks about in XP Explain. We have stand-ups, retros, we sit shoulder to shoulder with our team. All of these things that we do are reflections of our values and reinforcements to them as well. So the values are important. We are predictive rather than prescriptive. We don't use velocity as a bludgeon to beat our engineers with, right? We use it as a predictive tool, at least ideally. We're test-driven, TDD to the core. We write the test first, we learn from it, we write our code to pass. This was one of the things that we talked about yesterday as being absolutely fundamental to what XP is. And finally, we're iterative. We work in small increments, delivering the smallest verifiable units of customer value. Right? So this is what makes our engineering organization extreme. But how do these things apply to product management? First off, we're team focused. And what does that mean here? So let's take a look at how a normal team works. Typical product managers, sometimes called product owners, sit in this awkward middle space between the business interests and the engineering team. And you can have Agile over here, all the Agile you want, but your organization isn't really Agile and you're not really getting the benefits out of this unless you change the structure of this a bit. This ends up being a very painful position, right? Because it turns out that you've got all these people who are giving requirements, and it's your role to pass those requirements on to these people who are pushing back on those requirements, saying, no, 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 that's a dumb way to do that. And so this person always ends up being very unhappy, unless they're a megalomaniac, which some of them are, and then they're just unpleasant to work with. These people are required to create a long-term product roadmap that's always based on someone else's business vision, and then ensure that the engineers build that roadmap. So, the model that we prefer to adhere to here is called Balanced Team. Is anybody familiar with Balanced Team already? You are. Have you been to a Balanced Team meeting or conference or any of those things?
No, there is a conference.
Balanced Team is a real thing. Like, it's not just a, like, it's not a couple of words that are jammed together. This group has been around since 2009, I want to say. And they have conferences and they have regular meetings. And one of the things that they were trying to do back in 2010 was figure out how to make design work with Agile. Because design process has typically been a very waterfall process kind of from ages on, right? And so this was a group of people who were avid Agile practitioners and experienced designers getting together and talking about, like, how do we actually change the design process to make it fit? And that was where Lean UX was born. So Janice, my wife, was a member of this group, and she was going out there and talking to these people and figured out that, like, Lean Startup could actually be the key to make design work better with Agile. And so she brought that to them back then, a very long time ago. But anyway, the idea behind Balanced Team is that instead of having one person who owns the product, for 1 second. Anybody here know Ian McFarland?
Yeah.
Okay. Ian, old school pivot, right? He probably is the one responsible for opening this office. He was then the one responsible for buying this office for Neo when he started Neo. Ian has this thing. Own. Stands for one ringable neck. I love that. Instead of being a product owner, being that person who's stuck in the middle between the business and the engineering team, we can have business representation in the form of a product manager working together directly, side by side, with engineering and design in order to steward the product to a successful outcome, right? So this is the product in the middle here. And instead of having one person who owns this thing and everybody else sort of works for them in this command and control-like relationship, everybody on the team is responsible for producing a successful outcome for the whole team, right? So in service to the team, the engineers get to say, you know what? I have a really interesting technical solution for that problem. I understand that problem because the design team was able to identify the problem with the customer, explore the problem deeply, and communicate that well to the rest of the team. Given that information, I have a good solution for it. Product management then gets to say, you know what, the business interests that are involved here actually require this one little tweak, and then we can make, you know, we can make a solution that's good for everybody, right? We're looking at things that are not only feasible from a technical perspective and desirable from a customer perspective, but they also have to be viable from a business perspective, right? So each one of these, you know, legs of the stool or blades of the propeller, I guess is probably better for this illustration, each one of these has their own area of responsibility that they get to contribute to bringing the product to a successful outcome. But like Kent said yesterday in his talk, no problem at Facebook is someone else's problem, right? This team works together, and everyone on the team is responsible for making sure that we're successful. So if you see a problem, you have to speak up about it, even if it's not technically your area of expertise. So, let's see.
I think that's really important, that last part that you mentioned about the ability to speak up and to be able to do so without people feeling like you're stepping on their toes by suggesting something.
Yeah. When it's the culture of the team that, like, we're all working towards this one common goal and we're all willing and able to let go of our own egos and let go of our own need to be right all the time about things, then everybody's able to step in when something goes wrong and take care of it, right? But if the people on the team are proprietary in things, right?
Yeah.
This is one of the things that pairing helps to overcome, right? So pairing is there, you know, for a lot of reasons, but one of the reasons is to prevent code hoarding, right? When somebody goes off on their own in their own little hole and pounds out a bunch of code and says, this is done, I solved that problem, you guys don't have to think about this anymore. Suddenly they've got this little thing that they own, right? And if you start to question it or poke at it, they're gonna be all defensive of it. No, 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 I solved that problem. Let's just move on to the next thing, right? And you don't want that on a team. It's like, it's
That's a word that I used to hear a lot about, and I used to hear a lot at some of the large organizations that I worked with.
Ownership. Yeah. So the model here is stewardship, not ownership. And that actually comes from Tim McCoy, who was our, he was design director at Labs for a while. Now he's working in the data group at Labs, but we're not at Labs, at Pivotal. But he was one of the original founders of the balanced team sort of concept, and product stewardship was his like big thing. So Kent mentioned pairing in his talk yesterday, right? And it's absolutely fundamental to extreme programming. But it turns out that that this pairing that our engineers do is equally valuable across other roles on the team. So when PMs pair with designers or our business partners or our engineers, we get the same benefits, right? And those benefits are things like faster, more elegant solutions, reduced errors, better team continuity, and no handoffs. All that makes sense? So, next. So we talked about team focused. We're PMs here are values driven, okay? We believe deeply, it's too bright in here. We believe deeply in the communication, simplicity, courage, and feedback. So product managers are often in a position of helping our clients to understand and embody these values. And we're the ones who end up having the hard conversations with them about how their behavior affects the team, and ultimately how that effect on the team can have an impact on the product. Right now, you're serving the role of the product manager, and you're having to have these hard conversations with your customer. And many of us, even as engineers or designers, we're going to have these conversations anyway, or as well. But it seems what I've seen in labs offices back home over the last 2 years is that somehow it often ends up falling on the PM's shoulders to have these conversations, because they're typically the one, since they're kind of abstracting the client from the anchor, they're the one who spends the most time like sitting shoulder to shoulder with the client and looking at the backlog and prioritizing. So we have to help them simplify. We have to help them give and receive honest feedback, and to have the courage themselves to tell their stakeholders the truth about the ongoing project. I don't know if any of you have seen clients hide things from their superiors. Is this a thing? A nod here or there? Yeah, it doesn't help the project in the long run, does it? So if you're sweeping problems under the rug, they're going to creep out at some point and cause problems later. So we have to help our clients understand and deal with that. Next, we're predictive rather than prescriptive. This is kind of really where the rubber meets the road here for our PMs. We have the hardest conversations with our clients in this category. The biggest part of our job is helping the client understand how to manage and prioritize a backlog, right? And understanding that a backlog is a single track prioritized list is revolutionary for most of our clients. And for some of them, it's excruciatingly uncomfortable. Like, what do you mean we're not going to parallelize? And what do you mean I'm not going to get everything I want? So everybody wants to know that they're going to get all of the things in the amount of time that we have. And we know that promising scope and time is a recipe for disaster. So we say, yes, you will get everything you want in the amount of time we have. But in order to do that, we have to be very careful about choosing what you want. We have to limit what you want, right? And that can be a very challenging conversation. So we work with the client to refine the product vision and pare it down to the bare minimum. And this allows us some room to add in new features at any point in the process, as long as we're willing to deprioritize other things. And this way of working, along with the automated iteration markers in Tracker, makes it easy to see the cost, either opportunity cost or cost in time, associated with adding scope. And it lets us incorporate the things that we're learning from our users while we're building the product, ultimately shaping the product into something that is small, simple, and hopefully maximally useful. Okay, next. We're test driven. Okay? We do experiments. Did I get my experiment slide? Yes. To the extent that our clients are ready for it, we work to validate our product's vision and features by crafting small experiments. Not every client is going to let us do this, right? A lot of clients are going to come in and they're just going to say, we need to build this thing. I don't care if you think it's the right solution or not. Yes.
This typically be where you want to discover the right market fit for the customer.
So
the areas are.
This is actually way before product market fit. This is the stage called problem solution fit, typically. So, and there's a good book if you want to know more about this stuff called The Entrepreneur's Guide to Customer Development. It's by Brent Cooper and Patrick Blaskowitz. It's like the Cliff's Notes to the Steve Blank book, Four Steps to the Epiphany, which no one should ever read because it's so awful. And in fact, if you go to a conference and you stand up in front of 400 people and say,